This is one of the regular public lectures that the Conspiracy and Democracy Project puts on. Many of you will know about this project, but in case you don't, it's a five-year Leverhulme-funded research project based in Crash with three strands. One of them is historical, one of them is political theory, and the other is an internet strand. From the beginning, we've had an ambitious program of visiting fellows, people who come to work with us for short periods, on aspects of their work and our work that intersect. And because we firmly believe there should be no such thing as a free lunch, we require them to give a public lecture, and this is the latest example of the exacting that tribute. So, tonight's lecturers are two of our current visitors, Ben Oppenheim and Kelly Greenhill. Kelly is an associate professor in the Department of Political Science at Tufts University, and a research fellow and chair of the Conflict, Security and Public Policy Working Group at Harvard's Kennedy School of Government. Prior to coming to Tufts, she's had fellowships at Stanford Center for International Security and Cooperation and at Columbia University's Salzman Institute of War and Peace Studies. So she collects universities the way people collect stamps. She's the author of Weapons of Mass Migration, Forced Displacement, Coercion and Foreign Policy, which won the 2011 International Studies Association Best Book of the Year Award. And she's co-author and co-editor with Peter Andreas of a book which has an intriguing title, Sex, Comma, Drugs, and Body Counts, The Politics of Numbers and Global Crime and Conflict, which is published by Cornell. Ben Oppenheim is a senior fellow at New York University's Center for International Cooperation and a fellow of Stanford University's Center on International Conflict and Negotiation. His research focuses on transnational security challenges, aid in development, and fragile states. He's also published on conflict dynamics and post-conflict reconstruction, and on rumor dynamics. He's held research fellowships at the Institute of Global Conflict and Cooperation and at Berkeley's Institute of International Studies, where he was a Simpson Fellow. They'll talk for about 35 minutes, and we'll then turn over to questions and discussion. And afterwards, we will have drinks outside. So please welcome Kelly and Ben.
Thank you all so much for braving the weather and coming out to join us. And a very warm thank you to the Conspiracy and Democracy team for making us feel so very welcome during our stay here.
I'd like to echo Ben's thanks on that front.
So let's start with a story. Slightly strange story that began to circulate in 2002-2003 in southern Thailand. And the story was a rumor that ninja warriors were roaming the countryside raping and pillaging and killing as they went. Now, on its face, this story is absurd. Why would spies and assassins linked to feudal Japan be loose, far from home in southern Thailand, hurting people? But the rumor was taken seriously, at least by some. Villagers cohered into a mob, bulled their way past village headmen, and tracked down two men in black, who were conveniently at hand, two policemen, in fact, and killed them. And what's more, this event is eerily reminiscent of similar sudden escalations in violence that had occurred in Indonesia in the previous decade. So the loss of two lives is tragic, but rumors can have much broader, much deadlier consequences. Rumors of electoral fraud, ballot box stuffing in Kenya led to violence that displaced hundreds of thousands and killed thousands. The rumor that the Rwandan president Habyarimana's plane was shot down by Tutsi rebels helped spark the genocide. And rumors have been linked to massive instability in post-conflict countries, where backsliding into violence can take place quite quickly. So they're deadly business. Rumors can have grave consequences. But there's very little empirical evidence on the factors that dispose people to accept rumors, or at least entertain them, and very little empirical evidence on why people further disseminate rumors, why they pass them on. So this is what we set out to understand, particularly in the context of war-affected populations. So the plan for today is to look at some existing explanations for rumors, who believes them, under what conditions and why, and who transmits them, put forward a theory and some testable propositions, some hypotheses, test those using some data we gathered from original surveys in conflict and post-conflict areas, and then think together, perhaps especially in the question and answer, about the findings that we generate and the implications for policy. So with that, we'll turn to Kelly.
So before we go any further, a couple of definitions are in order. First, what do we mean by a rumor? A generally accepted definition is that of Walker and Blaine, which the rumor is a proposition or belief in general circulation within a community without proof or evidence of its authenticity. This is to say, it is a source of information designed to influence its recipients that is unverified or unverifiable at the time of transmission, could well turn out to be true, but it cannot be shown to be true at the time of transmission. Rumors tend to come in two variants, what are known as wish rumors, which are rumors associated with pleasant or desired, wished for, hoped for circumstances or events, and dread rumors. Dread rumors tend to be more commonly disseminated than do wish rumors, and dread rumors, as the name intimates, are associated with calamitous circumstances or feared outcomes. What purposes do rumors serve? Rumors have a couple of different functions. Primarily, rumors, they are most often spread when hard facts are hard to come by, rumors help to fill holes in people's knowledge, to help them overcome uncertainty, to deal with anxiety and fear, providing offerings kind of shared explanations or shared senses of what has happened. Sometimes we think of this as collective problem solving, in the absence of fact. They can not only serve to reduce psychic psychic unease and reduce fear, but also serve as a source of actionable intelligence, sort of a guide to behavior. And this can be a positive thing, sort of helping people to engage in sort of collective problem solving when good information is hard to come by, but when rumors fill in the blanks in ways that are dangerous, sometimes nefarious, they can also be quite dangerous. So there are three different classes of explanations out there regarding who believes in rumors and under what circumstances. We do have a pretty good sense of what the function of rumors are and why they're spread, but who believes them and under what circumstances is still highly contested, shall we say. So one class of explanation focuses on what one might think of as individual level differences. And these can be things like socioeconomic differences, such as education and income. The interesting thing is that there is not agreement, even among those who think that education and income matter, about whether or not we should see greater rumor receptivity among those with low education or high education, and the same holds for income. Now, I would say sort of on balance, there are more people who believe that rumor receptivity is associated with low education and low income, but that's not universal. Another class of individual difference explanations surround issues of age and or gender. In common parlance, some people say women are more likely to be receptive to rumors than are men. Whether this is, however, due to genetic differences or social environmental factors, also a point of dispute. And then there's a third variety of individual explanations that are tied to individual psychology. And some of the most commonly known explanations surround expectations that there are some people who are particularly conspiratorially minded. Cass Sunstein talks about people with crippled epistemologies or some other form of mental defect. But so these are various different competing explanations having to do with individual psychology. A second class of explanations are tied to, might loosely be thought of as environmental factors. We're within this category, we're talking about socio-cultural differences, political differences across different countries and environments. Richard Hofstadter wrote a very influential book that focused on the unique nature of American politics in the 1960s, just one example. Other variants of the environmental conditions theories focus on things like differences that might be expressed in the context of religion, ethnicity, different forms of identity. So that's another class of explanations. Another environmental explanations, they're here too, there isn't agreement about which way the arrow should go, is that rural inhabitants are differentially susceptible to rumors vis-a-vis urban inhabitants. And there are two variants of this set of theory as well. Some people might say folks who live in rural environments are more susceptible to rumors because they're in a more information-starved environment. And then there's a regime-type variant that says that it's kind of semi-convoluted, but we're more likely to see rumors in societies that are more rural, and many of those societies in modern day and age tend to be less liberal, more semi-liberal authoritarian, and so we might see greater rumor receptivity among those rural populations. We, on the other hand, make a slightly different hybrid argument, which is not to say that sometimes individual differences don't matter, or that cultural and environmental differences don't matter, but rather all individuals are susceptible to rumors. It's really contingent on the content of the rumor in play and the context into which the rumor is introduced. Now, this is not to say that every given rumor is going to be appealing, or that every given rumor will have an audience, you know, all individuals susceptible to every given rumor, but rather that for any given rumor, there are a group of individuals who will find it, if not true, at least plausible. So it's really, really rumor content and social context that matters. In thinking analytically about rumor receptivity, we divide receptivity of receptive groups into three. The first are, we've already used the term, right, receptive. These are folks who require little or no persuasion to be convinced that the rumor is, if not plausible, true. Second group are those that we think of as agnostic. They're not saying that they believe it. They require a bit more persuasion to be convinced of a rumor's plausibility or believability, but they're open to the prospect. And then the third class are skeptics. And as the name implies, these are folks that reject the rumor out of hand. So what factors determine who falls into the receptive, the agnostic, or the skeptical camp? We hypothesize that there are three key variables that interact and influence receptivity to rumors. The first is what we call worldview, and I'll say a little bit about each of these in turn. So worldview, just loosely speaking, is how consonant or discontinent a rumor is, through the content of a rumor is, with an individual's worldview. Fits with its ideology and so on. I'll come back to it in a minute. Second factor that matters is individual's threat perception, sort of the extent to which a rumor's content relates to the source of the threat, sort of how worried is a particular individual about something that either touches on the rumor directly or is tangentially related to the rumor content. And then the third factor that we think or hypothesize matters is whether or not an individual is exposed to a rumor or a particular rumor or a similar rumor in the past. So to formalize these or operationalize them in the context of hypotheses, we argue, let me actually back up for just a second and say a little bit more about worldview, threat perception, and exposure. Since John told us that we have a little bit more time, I'm going to see some of it. So why might worldview matter? Worldview might matter because we've known for a long time that how information is taken in or absorbed by any given individual is contingent pretty seriously or heavily contingent upon what one believed already. Right? So it's sort of how easily the content of a rumor nestles within an individual's existing view will be pretty predictive of whether or not a given rumor will matter. So rumors that fit nicely within a worldview, more likely to be accepted. One key way in which worldview can matter is how an individual views the entities, groups, or individuals are implicated in particular rumors. So in the context of rumor adoption, individuals should we say, more likely to believe rumors that assign guilt, responsibility, or culpability to those individuals, groups, or organizations about which they already feel skepticism, hostility, or distrust. So get to the hypothesis in a minute, right? As we should expect to see a relationship, strong relationship between trust and worldview. With respect to threat perception, it's worth noting that worldview doesn't operate in a vacuum. Sort of how easily or uneasily a rumor will nestle within a particular individual's worldview is attenuated, augmented, or mitigated by an individual's level of fear or anxiety about issues related to the rumor, as I already said. So all those things being equal, sort of ceteris paribus, as threat perception goes up, so will the likelihood that of rumor adoption. Now, it's worth noting that, as I already said, sort of worldview and threat perception can attenuate or sort of act in an additive way or mitigate one another depending on the content of the rumor. And finally, repetition can matter for three interrelated sets of reasons. Number one, we know from a whole raft of psychological studies that simply by nature or simply by virtue of exposure to information, individuals are sort of primed to be affected by a variety of psychological biases. So recency bias, saliency bias, sort of if something has already been, so it's been introduced into sort of put into an individual's brain, it'll be more readily accessed, and so they're more likely to sort of draw upon it. We can talk about the raft of potential different biases, but suffice it to say for the moment that, you know, from a psychology standpoint, there are about a dozen of them. In addition, and quite problematically, because what I'm about to tell you, study after study after study has shown that individuals suffer from what I'm about to say, but study after study after study has also shown that every individual thinks this happens to other people, but not to them. but here it is. Individuals systematically and routinely forget where they've learned things. And they systematically and routinely forget where they've learned things within a period of about 7 to 10 days. So even something that someone understood was a fictional piece of information or a questionable piece of information at the time of transmission can, in a pretty short period of time, transmute into a credible source of information. In addition, there's some psychological studies that have shown that when we transmit ideas that we find interesting or engaging, we transmit the content, but we don't transmit our level of credulity in the information. So there too, you know, as we're spreading, hey, did you hear this, you know, this story, we're transmitting the ideas and the information and the intensity of the belief, but actually I don't think it's true. Right. So all of these things added together can turn even the most absurd, questionable, you know, pieces of information from dubious sources into potentially more credible sources of information relatively quickly. So exposure can matter. So when operationalizing these, thinking about them in the context of hypotheses, we suggest that as distrust in an implicated entity, individual, or group rises, so will the likelihood that a rumor will be perceived as, if not true, at least plausible. So as distrust rises, so will probability of belief. Added to that, with respect to threat or threat perception, as threat perception rises, so will the likelihood that a rumor will be considered possibly or definitely true. And with respect to exposure, if an individual has heard a rumor before, the likelihood that it will be viewed as possibly or definitely true rises. And back over to Ben.
So as I mentioned earlier, there's a raft of anecdotal evidence about the role that rumors can play in violent and unstable areas. But up until now, no systematic empirical analysis of rumor dynamics in those kinds of contexts. And we had an opportunity through a collaboration between the Asia Foundation and the World Bank to study rumors through two large-scale population surveys in active conflict areas. I'm never good with these pointers, but let's try them. In Southern Thailand, here, where it joins Malaysia, and in Mindanao, in the Philippines. So it's worth saying a couple words about both of these conflicts. They're both long-running, multi-generational separatist insurgencies, which have flared episodically over a decade. So the Southern Thai insurgency, depending on who you ask, goes back either 10 years or 100 years, depends on if they're kind of counting prior generations of conflict, with no end in sight for the moment. And Mindanao, at the time we were studying it, was locked in the midst of a very long civil war between Moro ethnic separatists and the central government. also going back many, many generations, hundreds of years, depending on how you count these things. At this point, they're in late stage peace talks, and that becomes important for a couple of reasons we'll talk about later. So you'll see a lot of red dots on this map. That's because this type of insurgency, at least in Southeast Asia, is the most common form of violence. South Asia as well, ethno-nationalist insurgency. And it's increasingly common, this kind of violence, in sub-Saharan Africa, all of Africa, from Maghreb to South Sudan. So we think about our findings as speaking not just to Southern Thailand, just to Philippines, but beyond these cases, regionally and globally, and to non-conflict areas as well. So here's the trick. To study rumors, we first had to catch them. And what we did was begin to catalog dread rumors that were actively circulating in the deep south of Thailand and in Mindanao. And this happened in two phases. So first we examined international and local news sources to begin to just build out a compendium of rumors that we knew had reached a high level of circulation. And we began to sort of sort them into family groups, resemblances. I'll talk about that more in a moment. And then we did a fair amount of local field work, meeting with local researchers, conflict experts, key informants at the village level. We held meetings in tea houses, town halls, other public spaces. And as I said, tried to gather families of rumors in the kind of taxonomic sense of the word family. Rumors which implicated particular actors with particular plans, intents, motivations in more or less the same kind of causal sequence. And we tried to sort these into short, crisp, distilled narratives, which are here. So, I don't know if you can all read these. It's never polite to read at people when you can do it yourselves, but if you raise your hand if you can't. The choice of rumors had some ethical implications, right? We wanted to avoid seeding rumors, spreading rumors about violent things in violent places. And our IRB was also quite concerned that we not tell dangerous rumors to people, nervous people in volatile places. So we tried to choose rumors that were politically salient, but not necessarily bearing on conflict dynamics themselves. Yeah, so we chose two dread rumors from each country, one security-related, one economic. So the Southern Thai rumor concerns a potential coup by military elements. That rumor became true in 2014 when Yingluck Shinawatra was deposed by Prayuth Chan-o-cha, backed by a conservative faction. The economic rumor, which is a bit hard to parse perhaps, concerns rapacious government elites who were manipulating the dam system to flood large swaths of territory and buy it back up on the cheap. In the Philippines...
Allegedly.
Talk about that in Q&A. Allegedly. In the Philippines, the rumor concerns peace negotiations between the government and the insurgent MILF, and the story goes that some figures unnamed within the government were negotiating in bad faith and attempting to engineer the negotiations to cause fragmentation in the MILF, to weaken the group, to cause it to splinter, so they'd have a weaker bargaining position and presumably a poorer position in the post-conflict phase. And lastly, another rumor, this one has been shown to be true, the economic rumor in the Philippines concerned the misuse of internal revenue allotments. Philippines is a highly decentralized government to buy votes rather than provide public services. So those are our rumors. And we studied them through a population survey, two population surveys, fielded in 2012, as we mentioned, in conflict-affected areas of southern Thailand and Mindanao. And a survey is it's basically a structured conversation between strangers. And in this case, we had a couple thousand strangers in Thailand, 2,000 in total, 1,500 in Mindanao. And the goal of this was to give us a representative sample, a sample that resembled the overall population in terms of level of education, access to livelihoods, income, assets, social identity, and conflict exposure. That last one was tricky, and we can talk about it a bit in Q&A. This photo is two members of the team relaxing in Thailand after an extremely grueling day testing, pre-testing endlessly the survey instrument. And here's a quick snapshot of the sample. So we've got roughly 50-50, actually exactly 50-50, male and female in Mindanao. Thailand, we skew female because of regular patterns of seasonal migration, male laborers. Wide range in age, the survey was 18 and over only, but we go up to 94. And people at the far end of the age curve have interesting things to say. Widely ranging educational attainment, right? This is a key object of interest for us because there is such strong folk wisdom, or formal wisdom, about the role of education in structuring the way people think about unverified information. So these are both middle-income countries, so you rarely find people who have no formal education whatsoever. There's a big bump of people who've completed primary school, and it begins to tail off. And lastly and importantly, we captured a pretty large sample of both ethnic minority populations, by far the majority in southern Thailand, linked to the civil war, and sizable sample of national plurality populations, so Buddhists in Thailand, Christians in Mindanao. So let's go back to our rumors for a minute. Since the dread rumors were gathered from the field, we should expect to see some level of prior exposure, and we found it. In Thailand, about 1 in 5 had heard each of the rumors. In Philippines, the exposure level was quite a bit higher. Almost half the population had heard the IRA, the Internal Revenue Allotment rumor. And importantly, for our analysis, there's also wide variation in belief level. So in Thailand, you don't get that many people who say they're outright receptive, 4 or 5%. Get a lot of agnostics, though, a fair number of skeptics. In the Philippines, across both rumors, things are pretty evenly split. Right? About a third receptive or more for the IRA rumor, third agnostic, third skeptical, and fairly low non-response rates. So most people were willing to talk about these things. We found that to be the case both in one-on-one interviews and again through the structured conversation of the survey. So what explains that variation in belief level? Why do we have this distribution of skeptics, agnostics, receptives? So the theory again is that worldview, threat perception, and exposure all can jointly condition whether a rumor, whether a person believes a rumor to be true, plausible, untrue. In our statistical analysis, we wanted to take other factors into account: age, income, social identity. And this is both so that we can get a handle on how these factors are structuring belief in particular rumors, and also so that we can control for, filter out their influence, and get an unbiased measure of the key things we want to get at. Worldview, threat perception, and exposure. So we can talk about the mechanics of the statistical analysis in Q&A. I've learned through long and painful experience that PowerPoint and regression tables are not friends, but we do have them, so we can talk that stuff through. What this tries to do is give a kind of short, intuitive sketch of what we found, the relationship between our hero variables and belief in the rumors. And I don't know if you can see the bottom, but a plus is a positive and statistically significant correlation. So there's a plus linking worldview and the coup rumor. People who had an attitude that was distrustful towards government or towards the military were also more likely to believe the rumor. And across the board, we see that exposure, start at the bottom, has the strongest effects. It varies by rumor, but having heard a rumor before made people between twice as likely and 8 times as likely to believe it. Having a worldview that's congruent with a rumor makes people on average about 50% more likely to believe it. High levels of threat perception for the security rumors made respondents about 25% more likely to believe the rumors. So the effect is quite large. For the economic threat perception, which you'll see third row down, what we find is sort of a positive association, but suggestive, not statistically significant. And we think that that might be because of the way that we're measuring economic anxiety. Security anxiety is measured through the respondents' subjective assessment of whether there's likely to be a security incident, violence, in their locality in the coming year. Economic anxiety was their subjective assessment of their likely socioeconomic status in the coming year. So on the one hand, we have an event, the economic indicator is more about a state of being. It's less crisp. So that suggests some potential innovations in how we measure this kind of anxiety in the future, something that we might carry forward.
Do you want to say anything about the ethnicity piece?
Oh, sure.
Just because we don't speak to it anymore.
Yeah, no, and we'll want to talk about this more in Q&A. So as Kelly mentioned, it's interesting. Actually, I can't show you anything exciting with this. I'll sort of want to show you a regression table. We'll get there later. What we do find across both countries, all rumors, is that the ethnic minority respondents are systematically less likely to believe the rumors by a lot, half as likely. On the whole, they're much, much more skeptical. We can talk about why. So I'll give you my folk explanation. We can talk about whether it holds water. These populations, again, are in the midst of active conflict. If they jumped at every single interesting piece of information that floated through their community and into their ears, they couldn't possibly live. So I think they've had to develop quite strong cognitive filters. Untestable for now, something I'd love to explore later. We can amplify it a bit when we've got regression tables and coefficients to talk through.
We also found, contrary to what some of the competing explanations suggest, no consistent relationship between gender and rumor receptivity. If there was any relationship at all, it actually appeared that men were more receptive to the rumors than women, but the finding was not statistically significant. There was no consistent statistically significant relationships between education or income and receptivity. So we did find some relationships in some countries, in some cases, but across rumor and across country, the signs would flip, the significance would change. There was just no consistency, whereas we did find consistency across countries and across rumors with our hypothesized variables. Social capital did correlate. This is not something that we were looking, sort of did not formulate a hypothesized theoretical relationship, but we did find a statistically significant and robust relationship between social capital as expressed in local civic participation, sort of involvement on a local level, with rumor receptivity. And this, on one hand, is a bit counterintuitive. It runs counter to some other explanations or other literature that's out there about political participation, but it could be explained maybe quite readily by greater civic participation means greater exposure, more repetition, and so on and so forth. We have other potential explanations, folk or otherwise, that we are happy to discuss during the Q&A, but thought we'd put it out there. In terms of a preview finding, something that goes beyond the paper, the next paper we're working on focuses on the significance of source in explaining not only rumor uptake, but also rumor diffusion or dissemination. And the baseline expectations from the literature that's out there suggest that elites tend to play a key and critical role in the both in terms of who believes rumors and what rumors get spread. And in the work analysis we've done so far, it actually appears that elites play quite an important but a more subtle and nuanced role than what some of the literature would suggest. First, we discovered that it's actually quite rare for elites to be the primary source of rumors. Rumors are most often gathered from mass media and or from social networks, so friends and family. However, when elites do share rumors, on those rare occasions, they're almost invariably believed and almost invariably spread further. This holds, however, only for security rumors. So for security-related rumors, if you hear it from an elite, you're off to the races. We found no relationship of note heretofore with respect to economic rumors. So in terms of implications of the research we've done so far and the research we intend to do going forward with respect to conflict, we've known for quite some time that rumors can serve as a root underlying cause of conflict, as a proximate trigger for episodes of mass violence, even for as triggers for genocide. What is arguably less well known, we're beginning to get some findings, suggest that rumors also can play a key role in terms of the prospects for peace or impediments to peace. So we have, we're still playing with this data, but we feel we can decisively say that as aggregate credulity in rumors, sort of people who are more receptive to the rumors on offer, in the aggregate, as credulity in rumors increases or rises, so does belief in conflict intractability. So by as much as sort of 75%, if you are if you believe in the basket of rumors that we had on offer, you're 75% more likely to believe that conflicts are intractable. And this can translate in the real world into sort of quite consequential implications for pressure on elites, right, to press for peace or to essentially say, look, these peace negotiations aren't going to go anywhere. Why not simply escalate the war? Right? So it can have real implications for the future of conflict dynamics. And we can talk about some of the as yet untested hypotheses for why this might be the case. I'll let them close.
So we've told you a story about the dynamics of rumors in Thailand, in the Philippines. As we mentioned at the outset, this is not just a Southeast Asia story. I mentioned Kenya early on. So Rumours circulated by SMS in the 2011... 2008 Kenyan presidential election were linked to quite intense violence, so much so that in 2013, or in the run-up to 2013, there were multiple efforts financed both locally and internationally to track and counter Rumours, to project information via SMS to stop the spread of unverified information or introduce new pieces of unverified information to counter those Rumours.
So in 2008, over 1,000 were killed and hundreds of thousands displaced. We did not see a repeat of this in 2003.
Not just a developing country story. A lot of Rumours have circulated in and around and about Ukraine during its recent unrest. Some of these suggest that the US and the EU is behind the recent destabilization. Other Rumours claim that at the core of the pro-democracy movement that drove Yanukovych from power is a neo-Nazi group, all sorts of exciting things. And lastly, Rumours can spread, take hold, proliferate, not just in weak states or conflict-affected states, but in stable states, especially during volatile moments, but in wealthy states like the US as well. It's sort of comforting to think that in the end the truth will will out, that people and institutions will sort fact from fiction. As this story from the New York Times shows, it can take years for Rumours like massive looting by African Americans during the Katrina crisis to turn into verifiable or falsifiable propositions. More often than not, or as often as not, the truth can be elusive. Our hope is that by knowing something about the conditions that make people susceptible to Rumours, or susceptible to spreading them further, can give us some tools to address them. So we'll close there, and I look forward to questions and conversation.
Thank you very much. So to the, can I just query one thing? You were surprised by the correlation between social capital and credulity.
Oh, not necessarily surprised, but just that it does run counter to some other studies.
Okay, I wonder what Robert Putnam would say to that.
What Robert Putnam would say about Rumours?
Yeah, about that particular finding. We can always ask him by Skype.
Yeah, I guess I could go down the hall and ask him. Let's see, what would he say about...
high social capital would suggest less feelings about threat, say.
Yeah.
But it depends on the context and the content of the Rumour. So okay. You know, Putnam would say something about high social capital, but this, I would say it would be highly context and content dependent. Yeah. And yeah. So we can't say anything universal.
Yeah, okay. Thank you. Question?
John.
I think it's responding.
Okay.
Oh. Sorry, I can
just take it as a question.
I couldn't wait to get that question in.
Oh, no, it was a big important question. Thanks a lot, Toby, Ben, and Kelly. That was fabulous. Really, I particularly liked your hybrid theory of Rumour receptivity. It's really egalitarian almost, the whole idea of women not being more receptive, like minorities not being. And it might say something about what happens when we do empirical work instead of just, you know, sort of theorizing on who's who's actually receptive or not. I'm going to ask you a few questions just to open it up, and you know, we can just take them as comments rather than as questions. So my first question, which is I'm sure you guys are already expecting this because this is hosted by the Conspiracy and Democracy Group, is really what is the relationship between Rumour and conspiracy theory? And the reason I ask this is because. Well, for one, the definition you guys have put up of Rumour, the Walker and Blaine one, which I assume you're using, that doesn't necessarily matter to some of the social phenomena you're actually studying. So I'm thinking particularly of the economic rumours of, say, Thailand, which seem very much like a conspiracy theory. So, you know, is it that particular funds are being misused and misappropriated? You know, so is there some nefarious, are these people working, conspiring in the dark for some nefarious purposes? So for me, that felt more like a conspiracy theory than as a Rumour, but I mean, that's just, this is not to sort of convert you to conspiracy theorist researchers, but to just sort of think a bit more about in what way does your work relate to conspiracy theorists. The second question is just on methodology, and I'm sure you're going to get a lot of questions here on the design and conduct of the surveys, but my question as an anthropologist is something slightly different, which is that I really appreciate the generalizability of your data. I really like the fact that you can actually extricate broader arguments from a study of four Rumours or whatever the number of Rumours are that you guys have looked at. But I'm wondering whether in this act of stepping back and being able to generalize, you don't lose some depth in it. So in the sense, I'm thinking, again, as an anthropologist, the way, say, someone like Victor Turner would have looked at rumor traditionally would be to follow a particular rumor in an area and then, you know, follow it through all sorts of people and do it through participant observation or through other means, like not necessarily call them into the town hall and then do the sort of semi-structured interview around it. So it's just more about, like, so again, this is not to say that there's anything lacking here. It's more to just think about what are the other ways in which rumor has been studied sociologically, anthropologically, or by cultural geographers, or even historically, and how does that sort of map onto this quantified way in which you're doing your work? And also, like, this is a horrible question and you don't have to answer it, but does your work at all give you any ideas of how you can turn a skeptic into a receptive or a receptive into a skeptic? Okay. Like, is there some sort of ways in which you can socially engineer, you know, through this research? Okay, and my final sort of question is really on your hypothesis on threat perception. So, I mean, I think the thing is that I find your other two hypotheses really, really pertinent and really convincing in terms of, you know, worldview and the amount they sort of exposed to it. But the threat perception one, I was wondering in the context of, I think, the point you were making just at the end about how this is not just about conflict and this is not just about the developing world, but actually we can think about this in places like the US and Ukraine, etc. You know, I mean, I think the fact that when your threat perception is high, which it would be in a post-conflict or conflict zone that you're studying, you're more receptive to rumors. I mean, that's sort of almost, I mean, I totally buy that. But then what does that do to your work in areas which are not conflict-affected areas, where threat perception does not necessarily figure as a significant environmental thing? Mm-hmm. And I mean, and that basically leads to my last question, which is really, I mean, again, just thinking about rumor. And the way sort of rumor has been otherwise studied has been as a form of social glue, as something that keeps communities together. And, you know, so if you think about rumor as not something that just happens in areas with high conflict or volatile situations, but we think of it as something that is part of our social lives. So it's just like a really banal example, but if you think of the way rumor and gossip, say, circulate within areas like, say, academia, right? Like, often we'd be like, oh, this rumor that this lectureship has opened up, but obviously it's reserved for so-and-so, or so-and-so is going to become head of department. No, we can't think of these as dread rumors.
Depends on the context and content.
Yeah, that's right. But I think the stakes are lower than, you know, will this peace conflict work, or who's going to rule this country, like will this coup be successful or not. So the stakes are a bit lower, and then rumor becomes something much more benign. It just becomes a form in which you sort of exchange informal information, and you... And I was wondering, how does that idea of rumor, that everyday kind of banal rumor and gossip that we all indulge in our lives everywhere in the world, how does that compare to the kind of rumors you guys are thinking?
Okay.
Sorry.
So do you want to play tag team? You want to start and I'll jump in? Or?
Sure.
Okay.
I was thinking we can't really answer your third question on film. Turning skeptics into believers.
We can speak in abstract general terms.
Code and language. I think I'll start with your second question. It's something that we've thought a lot about. Different methods get you very different levels of knowledge, kinds of knowledge. And it would be a beautiful thing to combine large-scale quantitative work on this with really textured and tailored qualitative works. We did some amount of field work, and we have some interesting data on how rumors function at the village level. A lot of it's identified, a lot of it would have to be handled carefully. It is true, though, that as we sort of abstract up and out, we lose some subtlety. And one thing we know from the qualitative literature from our own work in the field is that people are not static in their beliefs. They might be an agnostic one day, a skeptic another, a believer another. And knowing something about the kind of lived experience and volatility of belief over time would be powerful, and knowing something about how these how rumors structure behavior at the village level would be quite powerful. So I think I'll let Kelly go for this one too, agree enthusiastically. It's not what we're trying to do in this project, but it's highly compatible with the way we're thinking about things.
Do you
want to
touch anything else? I don't want to run the table for.
run the table for a minute, and I'll jump back
in. So, in answer to your first question, relationship between rumor and conspiracy theory. So I would say I don't think here too that they're incompatible, and as you know, because you've been subject or victimized to hearing us chat a couple times now, that we think of, or I should say we think of rumors and conspiracies as both part of, or sort of subsets of a larger class of information, which I call extra-factual information, which is, you know, sources of information that are unverified or unverifiable at the time of transmission, could be true, but cannot be shown to be true at the time of transmission, transmitted in order to influence, usually, right, simultaneously treated as unassailably true by one segment of society and unambiguously false by another in the same time period. And there's no reason why you can't have rumors about conspiracy theories. And both for better and for worse, unfortunately, sort of it's more sort of facile to think about tragic circumstances, but so often we see one form of EFI feed into another form of EFI, so it's not so unusual to have rumors about conspiracy theories. Ethan Bronner wrote this book about, you know, Rumour about the Jews, which touches on, you know, long-standing rumors about others, sort of religious beliefs giving rise to us versus them, giving rise to conspiracy theories about, you know, Jews trying to take over the world, which then become codified in these fictitious documents masquerading as fact, like the Protocols of the Elder of Zion, which are then, you know, picked up by the Nazis and used as government propaganda, another form of EFI, right? Information that cannot be shown to be verified or verifiable at the time of transmission, designed to influence people, and then used as, you know, sort of a, not a doctrine, but, you know, as sort of a blueprint for massacre, a genocide of people. So these are forms of information that are deeply intertwined and historically have been deeply interrelated, which is not to say, to go to one of your other questions, that rumors can't be benign. I mean, we did say at the outset, right, that we could distinguish between wish rumors and dread rumors. And wish rumors, and also some dread rumors, can serve as social glue and help people in times of stress and distress. The complicated piece really comes in, you know, not so much, well, some wish rumors can have dangerous undertones and overtones. Some dread rumors can be positive. The really interesting, perplexing, and potentially dangerous pieces come in when we're talking about both, because dread rumors for whom? Wish rumors for whom? If we're using rumors, or if groups are using rumors as instruments or tools of mobilization, but that's to create social glue, to protect their group and lead to political mobilization, but against whom? Right? This wish rumors, we're going to win, or we're going to change circumstances on the ground, so we're going to win, and that means bad things are going to happen to some other group. So good outcomes, bad outcomes, good and bad outcomes at the same time. With respect to threat perception, I apologize if this wasn't clear. When we're talking about threat perception, I would say in terms of broad threat perception and environmental threat perception, it is undoubtedly true that rumors tend to be spread more and are more prevalent and prolific in periods of stress and distress, high, if you will, aggregate levels of threat perception. But what we're tapping into, what we're trying to get at, is not global sort of macro threat perception, but rather threat perception related to a particular rumor. And that kind of threat perception can happen in peaceful societies. And they're, you know, it's not, anybody who spent any time in the United States is not going to be particularly surprised that the rumors that came out post-Katrina resonated with people. There weren't a lot of people who went down there and said, I'm going to go check to see if there's looting by, you know, African Americans and whether these killings are happening. Turns out all of this was bunk. But people believed it. And we can talk about, you know, American history and all sorts of reasons why there are particular threat perceptions that can be tapped into even now, even as far as we've come. So threat perception can be general, but what we're really tapping into is specific threat perception. And that can be present in peaceful societies, in conflict societies, and post-conflict societies. Do you want to jump in here? Because I'm running a lot of table here.
I'm vigorously agreeing.
Okay. So. I want to answer the question about debunking, but can we put a pin in it for now, take on some other questions, and maybe make sure we circle back to it before we end? Aaron? John, are you
no,
moderating?
Go
okay. Thanks. That was really interesting talk. I guess I wanted to get back to this issue of the source of the rumor, because it's really one of the things I found most interesting. I mean, Kelly, you were saying that we don't really remember, or people don't remember, the source of a rumor, but that doesn't necessarily mean that that doesn't matter. So I'm just wondering, I mean, and particularly if we now think about sort of new technology and ways that sort of information is transmitted, I would have thought that the source of the rumor would come into sort of those three explanations that you have. Like you could say it's sort of a national broadcaster or a newspaper that people find credible, as opposed to if it's, you know, the neighborhood barbershop. So I don't, if you could just talk a little bit more about that source.
So we don't look at source in the context of this first paper, and I don't think that's actually a problem for both theoretical and empirical reasons. And if the takeaway from our initial source finding is that source doesn't matter, that's not what we're saying. What the issue is that the role of elites is not necessarily as bumper sticker, sort of all elites all the time, as is commonly, I'd say universally, but commonly suggested. And so it's not that elites don't matter, and it's not that source doesn't matter. But if we're going back to, if we go back to the paper that we're, that most of this talk was drawn from, the authority, credibility, and plausibility of a source is kind of embedded in worldview in some sense. So we're not asking about the particular import of source. We don't need to from the perspective of what we're asking here, because we're saying who believes and under what circumstances. Source could be yet another variable, but what we've already identified carries a lot of water by itself. Now, we could play a little game where we essentially say, well, have you controlled for source? So Ben, do you want to, so I can tell you there's still an interesting story, even if we decide to complicate the story here and say, well, if you controlled for source, would the rest of your results go away? So the bumper sticker there is source matters, but it doesn't in any way undermine the findings about worldview, threat perception, and repetition. And if you understood what I was saying to mean that source didn't matter, that's not what we're saying. Simply, it matters in a slightly different way than the most common explanations or the most common theories that are out there suggest.
Yeah, so we didn't have time to run through it, but we can look at tables afterwards. Exposure comes in many forms, so we worried a lot about where people heard the rumor, how often they heard it, and we've done a variety of robustness checks to make sure that the core finding holds up irrespective of the initial source of the rumor. Looking at source on its own, just descriptively, it was for me, it was a little bit shocking to see that elites play such a small role as information vectors in highly rural societies, at least for the dread rumors.
And at least in the cases we looked at.
Yeah. Yes, we can't say generally, but in three countries, we didn't have a chance to talk about Aceh. Elites are not out there sort of brokering information constantly. People are getting the rumors from a lot of different sources, but mass media have great importance. That's the sort of the baseline source from which most people get their rumors. And in public spaces as well. So elites, when they do play a role, as Kelly said, it's sort of determinant, almost one-to-one in our initial analysis. If someone hears a security-related rumor from an elite, they'll project it back out into the world. So it's an early area of research, and there's a lot more to do. But
literally, we're talking about sort of orders of magnitude in terms of numbers, people who are hearing, say, or at least report that they're hearing it from elites as opposed to, say, from mass media. Which doesn't mean there aren't interaction types and so on and so forth.
Handfuls versus hundreds.
My questions are about so the mediation moderation between your three explanatory variables. So I would guess, you know, with regards to mediation, I would guess they're highly intercorrelated. I'm just thinking to myself, right? If my worldview is that the Obama government is highly likely, you know, to seize my guns and property, then I probably have a high threat perception if Obama's in office. And then I'm probably going to seek out sources of information that tell me that Operation Jade Helm, right, is actually a conspiracy to seize my guns and property, and they're building tunnels under Walmart and all of that. Right, so there's going to be some, so my worldview kind of determines what sources of information I look for, and also perhaps threat perception. I'm interested in how intercorrelated these things are, and to your credit, right, it would be interesting if they are highly intercorrelated and we still find significant findings. That would be unlikely, given the collinearity problems. The other thing is, on moderation, I would guess that, and here I'm thinking about Nyhan and Reifler talking about the backlash effect, right, that there's going to be an interaction between your worldview and your exposure to information, right?
So, there could be.
Or there could be, right? Right. So if I think that, influenza vaccines are actually a conspiracy by Big Pharma, mm-hmm. to, you know, just make profits, and they've covered up all these studies, right, showing that it causes autism or hysterical pregnancy or whatever the heck it's supposed mm-hmm. to cause, right? And you provide me with information trying to correct that belief, right? Instead of, you know, the two canceling each other out, right? Actually, it might just reinforce my existing belief. So I don't know if you tested for any interaction effects. So
empirically, and we can wander into tables in a moment.
Do you want to see regressions?
I'd love to.
Okay.
Okay. Actually, I don't know if
Did we allow the robust? Because I can play treasure hunt, or we can show you afterwards, Aaron,
okay.
if you
yeah,
want
that's
to.
But
we loaded the regression tables. I don't know if we loaded the robustness checks, but you can answer the question.
Yeah, I suspect they're not hiding on these slides, at least. We shared your concern, and it varies by Rumour. Rumour in my country. So in Thailand, we have a question about trust in the military on the one hand, and security anxiety or threat perception about local security incidents on the others. And for Malay Muslims, no surprise, right? There is a correlation between those two things. Yeah. Results hold up anyway. So we've run the model, right? Each variable separately, variables together. We've done interactions that make sense, and it sticks. I think not all these things go together, right? So there's less of a coherent story linking, you know, civilian members of the office of the president in the Philippines and local security incidents, right, in Mindanao.
Yeah.
So while taking your point in general, I think that it's not that tight a relationship for all the Rumours.
Sure.
But we can have fun with tables a little bit later on, but not inflicted on everyone else.
Hugo?
thank you for a very stimulating paper. I have a number of different thoughts that I think I just kind of launch at you and see what you do with it. They're not, I don't know if they're entirely questions or even fully fleshed out, but anyway. The first point, I suppose, had to do with, you put a lot of emphasis on Rumours as being triggers to violence. And I just wanted to see if you could flesh that idea out a bit more, because I was wondering, if you broaden it out, how much Rumour is going to play a role in this triggering of violence as opposed to other actions that may trigger violence. You see what I mean? So if you have violence so some of the examples that you gave, you say, okay, well, Rumour here seems to have played a role in the triggering of violence, but if other factors, whether it was like a crisis or whether something like that, could have also played a role in this. Just trying to figure out how important Rumour was mm-hmm. in this triggering of violence versus other elements that mm-hmm. could have triggered that violence in the first place. And I suppose the fundamental question there is whether it's what you mean by trigger. Is it trigger in a positive sense, in that it does actually activate violence, or whether Rumour is just an excuse for the violence which is coming in any case, right? So I suppose that was the first kind of thought I had. The second one was, especially that you mentioned about how you're interested in extra factual information and the role that, so how Rumour can be understood through that person. Because it might be the case, and I suppose this is a question about the longer term existence of Rumours, which obviously this type of work, if you're doing kind of more quantitative work, is sometimes harder a bit to capture. But I was just wondering if you had thoughts on this. Because what came to my mind was that you may have something that becomes a Rumour that's not at all a Rumour to start off with, right? That starts with somebody actually saying a fact, but then because of effects like Chinese whispers or whatever, it becomes something, one, that's completely different to what the original fact mm-hmm. might be. But secondly, people may have heard it, and it may be true, but they themselves have no way of actually proving it. However, if you actually were able to go all the way back, you'd be able to prove it. So in terms of the longer lifespan of Rumours and then what its relationship might be with facts or non-facts within the overall prism that you try to elaborate. The final point was just more of a, was just more something that came to mind, because you talk a lot about elites and the role that elites play in these areas. There's been some interesting work by somebody called Jeffrey Winters on oligarchies, right? And I was just wondering if there's any way that you saw there was any dialogue between your work and his work. In particular, I think because what the emphasis that he places is on how elites actually can foment and create rumors as a way of instigating a form of revolt or a form of a coup. So it's kind of not just, because you talk about elites also saying, okay, well, if they say yes, this is we've heard this rumor and we approve it. And not just that, but actually actively fomenting rumors and then going on because there's a specific political goal that they're trying to get. So I'd be interested in hearing if you had something to say about that. And I'm sorry, I've obviously overstayed my welcome, but the final point was I was very interested in what you said about minorities were less likely to believe certain rumors than others. And I wonder if this is again part of the elite question, which is, are they less likely to believe it because most rumors are actually propagated through types of social media which they feel themselves excluded from? Mm. So it's less a question of cognitive, which I think is very interesting. It's just a survival mode that they're much more able. But not only that, but they're going to distrust most of the sources of rumors in the first place if they're deconned by social media, which they themselves are going to associate with the people they're going to be against. So that's
So I won't speak for us both. You should jump in, please. On your first question about triggers, so in most cases, most places and times, rumors won't be by themselves a sufficient cause of violence. Right? What they can do is provide a handy narrative, sometimes for an elite, an entrepreneur, right, who has a big idea about what group he or she would like to make trouble for, or what government, what kind of social movement they'd like to stand up. And in that sense, rumors can provide an easy narrative, right? A sticky narrative, an excuse for violence. And there's some work by Finley and Kuklinski, I think, agent-based modeling that shows that in some conditions, a rumor by itself, right, absent a kind of information entrepreneur, can be sufficient for violence. So not just necessary, but sufficient. I don't know if you agree with me on this point.
I would just say also that we do know, and this is verifiable, that in the Kenya example in 2008, false information was transmitted via cell phone, and people showed up in places and did really nasty things to innocents based on unsubstantiated information. Now, were they already predisposed to think that their ultimate victims would be guilty of what they were charged with? Yes, right? Had there been conditioning by elites and others leading up to this that, you know, made this massacre waiting to happen? Yes, right? So it's not that the rumor just rose up sui generis, like there was a rumor and horrible things resulted, but we do know in documentable ways, and it's not unique to Kenya, that someone can say, this is happening, people show up and engage in mass violence.
Sorry, I didn't mean to question whether rumor can lead to it. It would be nice to have a broader scale, so the rumor can be, but there are other factors.
Oh, right, so there, it's not, right. Right. So,
yeah, so it's like, yeah. Rumored one, and then it would be nice to know if, like, okay, percentage-wise, rumor is like 15% likely to have violence. Another type of, I don't know, something else would be like 20.
So
putting it in relation to other types of triggers, I suppose. Yeah.
I suspect, well, I'd be happy, this is another thing we could talk about offline, about the research design that would allow one to tap into the relative percentages. First of all, I think it would be context dependent. I also think this would be really hard, and the endogeneity problems are
massive.
That said, I think this is one of these places where detailed ethnographic work could go a long way to say something about a particular case, which might give rise to testable hypotheses, and one then could go out and see, well, does this seem to fit? Does it map onto other circumstances and other contexts as well? But trying to quantify something like that, I think, is difficult. Well, I'm sure it's difficult. Is it doable? I'm open to persuasion. I'm agnostic, but leaning towards potentially skeptical. Let's see, other questions he had. Do you want to tackle the ethnic minority bit, or?
Yeah,
okay.
So there are a couple interesting features of the ethnic minorities story. Again, these are rural societies, and in southern Thailand, most of the people we're speaking with are living in a village context. And when you sort of picture that, it seems very pastoral, but they're highly connected, and they're connected to lots of local news sources that are meaningful to them and have pretty high fidelity from their point of view. So there's a lot of community radio, there's a lot of community news, there's a lot of blogging, there are a lot of localized social networks. And so I think your proposition's interesting, quite possibly right. In this specific case, it's not that they have wholesale distrust of the kind of sources that they have access to. They might think differently about sources from the National Center. And we don't have data on that in Thailand. We do in Indonesia, and it's something that we're going to look at, but haven't had the chance to yet.
It's certainly the case that elites can create rumors, and elites can create conspiracy theories, and elites can use some of these other sources to spread conspiracy theories and rumors and so on and so forth. And we know historically that they have. So this is something else we have to think about when tapping into the issue of source. But and in fact, I guess you weren't there last week, but dirty little secret is quite often even rumors that appear to be grassroots rumors from below are anything but, right? That these are things that have come from on high and been introduced and cultivated, from above or orthogonally at least.
In Thailand, the rumor about the coup has been traced by some people to Thaksin Shinawatra's group, right, trying to support his sister who's in power. Be very afraid someone's going to try and knock out a democratically elected government. So there is some evidence that these things are designed.
In our specific case.
As well
as more broadly. And in terms of the long-term relationships between facts and rumors and other forms of EFI, the book that I alluded to in answer when bringing up EFI does have 5 detailed historical case studies that track sort of where the information comes from, how potential attempts to debunk where it works, where it doesn't work, and cases where the EFI has measurable influence on the creation and implementation of foreign and defense policies. So we can talk about that offline, but you're absolutely right that the lifespan or life cycle of EFI and how it can change fact to fiction to unverifiable is a key piece of the puzzle.
Ella?
Thanks a lot for your presentation. I found your model of individual susceptibility really compelling. I have 2 questions. One is about this rumored effect area. And you have rumor here, fact here, but in between is a lot of shades of gray. And this is the territory of verification.
Mm-hmm.
And I would argue that just...
And or self-fulfilling prophecy.
Yes. But I would argue that just as much as we have an impulse to diffuse rumors, we also have an impulse to verify. And in fact, often swapping rumors can be a verification process. Mm-hmm. So I was just wondering to what extent you saw any of this dynamic in your research. That's my first question. And then my second question is, and I'm really interested to hear more as you sort of develop it and publish it, about the source angle. Because in my experience, the credibility of the source is really important, at least as part of the verification process. And so I was wondering if you thought about that in the context of your methodology, in the context of how much people were willing to say they believe these rumors, if actually the source of the rumor, when they encountered it, was an academic researcher who tends to be a credible category.
Oh, well, we could be at this for 25 or 30 minutes.
Thankfully, we weren't administering the survey. I don't know how credible they'd find us anyway. The enumerators were professional interviewers hired through local NGOs and firms, usually mid-20s, sometimes college students. And they look professional. They don't look authoritative, and they don't necessarily look elite. So we thought a lot about that kind of priming effect.
And
there was a very strong disclaimer. So this relates to the ethical quandary. Repeated. This is something we thought a lot about. So remember, we don't want to seed rumors. So at the outset of the rumor series of questions, the enumerator has their thing to read, and they read out a disclaimer that says, look, we're going to ask you some questions about some stories that have been going around. We're not saying these things are true.
They're hearsay.
And they repeat that several times. So if anything, they're being primed away from belief, which should in some sense undergird our findings. So I think we're both probably very strongly with you on this, on the importance of verification and on how people seek to verify information. Not all the rumors that people, in the context we're studying, most local elites wouldn't necessarily be a mechanism for verification. If you want to sort of think about what the Thai military is going to do, the village elder is not the guy who's going to be able to tell you. A little bit different for the MILF rumor, since that does concern local elites who were part of the peace process. And so it's extremely interesting. I'd like to do some digging and see what we can find out.
And there's a reason why Source is its own paper, because there's a lot of material to cover there, and it is a rich, I don't want to overplay this metaphor, but we agree with you. In short, it matters. Plausibility matters. Credibility matters. But you know, as I already said in answer to Devin's question, even if we take Source into account, the individual susceptibility model holds. So the rumor, the dynamics associated with Source and Rumours and EFI more generally are really important, but they are kind of their own thing, not unrelated to these issues, but individual susceptibility is driven by these factors. Source can also matter, particularly in the context of plausibility and credibility. And as you say, in terms of verification, in doing the large N work, tried to be pretty careful that these were in fact hearsay rumors, not facts that were just underpublicized. Now, some of them became facts. And we have no reason to believe we had played any role in that. These are epiphenomenally unrelated. But yes, facts can beget other rumors. Rumors can become facts because people behave in a particular way. So mutual intergroup hostility can beget. So I don't know how many political scientists are in the room, but political scientists talk about this thing called the security dilemma, where actors who are engaged in behaviors designed to enhance their own security, they could be acting purely defensively. You engage in behaviors that are viewed as threatening by their counterparts, who then engage in corresponding behaviors to protect themselves. And sooner, sometimes sooner rather than later, one's engaged in the very behaviors that were originally hypothesized, and hostility begets out and out war, if not simply arms races and heightened hostility. So there is self-fulfilling prophecy. There is, in addition, stepping back and sort of into the Southeast Asian context, there is human tendencies to be information seeking and to verify. We also know, though, from cognitive science that there's sort of two kinds of thinking, right? There's low-road emotional thinking and there's high-road reason thinking. And reason thinking is predicated on the gathering of more information and verification and slow thinking. We know from brain studies, and we also know from empirical on-the-ground evidentiary anecdotal studies, that people can be kept artificially in low road thinking. And when one is kept artificially in a high sort of sense of threat and tension, as can happen in the context of conflict, the tendency to seek out information and fact check is attenuated. And so we kind of have that sense from sort of talking to people on the ground and observing behavior, but we also know by hooking people up to MRI machines that different parts of the brain fire, and it's like a dirty little public secret that there are now people who are using this finding commercially. So neuromarketers who are trying to, are tapping into tribalism and getting particular areas of the brain to fire to keep people sort of emotionally responding. So I don't know, one could think of that maybe as a good thing, or maybe I'm more inclined to treat this with some skepticism and some level of concern. So you're absolutely right that we are information-seeking beings, but that can be manipulated as well. And in the context of war, a lot of lowered emotional thinking goes on.
Can I suggest, since there is a verifiable rumor, that there are glasses of wine out there?
Yes.
We take two more questions, Andrew and then David.
It's fact.
Sorry, I apologize firstly for actually arriving a little bit late, because I missed out on the definition, and actually I kind of find
definition is always interesting. But I got the impression. Okay, great.
We can verify this.
But am I right in inferring, therefore, from what I did catch, that you have a universal notion of rumours, that rumours appear virtually in all societies. And
they're not all equally consequential. Some die on the vine quite quickly, others stick around.
As a historian, I was just kind of thinking, can you tell us a history, a story of the rumour, a history of the rumour? Because if you'd say that it's just simply an anthropological constant, then really there's no story to be told there, in terms of specific case studies, but whether there's a larger story of the evolution of the rumour. And I just wonder how much that's connected to the story of the media environment. I would actually suspect, and the anthropologist in the room can correct me on this, but in a kind of a tribal culture where there is no writing, there is no notion of rumours. And I would say that actually only with writing then do you have a kind of another form of communication which creates the possibility to differentiate between oral communication and written communication. And rumours, I would suggest, are for the most part, they are a form of communication which is orally transmitted. I don't think rumours really get transmitted in newspapers or in print media, in books.
Okay. I'm going to have to disagree with you there. Actually, they're quite prolific on the internet, and they get,
text messages.
That would be therefore, and that's why I would therefore kind of push for the case that there is a kind of a history of the rumour to be told. Simply because when we come back to electronic media, it was just interesting, the image there, for example, from the Kenyan case, where you've got the man there with the mobile telephone. And therefore, all I'm saying is there a kind of a story to be, a history of the evolution of the rumour, rather than it being simply something which is a constant throughout society? And therefore, how does the electronic media using SMS, I would say, if the communication is ephemeral, then I think that's the perfect medium for rumours. If it's print media, then I don't think that that is actually a channel through which rumours are transmitted. But everyone was shaking their heads.
I think that's a verifiable fiction. We can talk about it offline. Ben may be able to tap into prehistory more readily than I can. I don't know how I would say something about whether rumors existed before we have a recording of history. I would hypothesize that they did exist because of the function that they serve, and because there's been variation on the availability of information forever.
Differentiate them from anything when it's just...
So, all right, so you're saying, one could say this is a philosophical question, but I would say, let's go back before there was language, and the only mode of transmitting information was oral, but there's still variation. So there's things that you have seen yourself, and other people have also seen, so you can corroborate them, as opposed to, I saw that, but did I actually see it? There are things that can be corroborated by others who are in positions of authority and influence. There are things that are corroborated by others, but they're only children. So there's differential reliability in information that's transmitted orally. Then there's the, I heard this from someone, and I think that that's a rumor back then, right? If it's not corroborated, it's unverified or unverifiable at the time of transmission. So I don't think this is provable. This is unverifiable. But I hypothesize that given that what we understand about the function of rumors or EFI more broadly, and what we know about how it spread and who's believed, plausibility and credibility, that they're not new. That doesn't mean that things haven't changed over time. And I think that the story that you're positing, that there might very well be a story there, and I think it could be quite interesting story in terms of changes over time across technology and media and societies and so on and so forth. But I'm the story might be slightly different than the one that was originally posited. We should definitely take David's question, but I also want to take a little bit of time to address the debunking issue, which we promised we would do, and I don't want to be...
Okay.
Okay.
I'll try to do this quickly. So just to go back to the elites, and as you said, that if it's a security rumor, hearing it from an elite gives place. If it's an economic rumor, it doesn't. That's your preliminary finding.
That at least based on these rumors,
so,
yeah.
The intuitive explanation for that would be, when it's a security rumor, the elite and the non-elite can be on the same side, same national group, same ethnic group. When it's an economic rumor, there's a kind of divide between them, in that the elite and the non-elite are not on the same side when it comes to economics.
Yeah.
Because the elite are wealthy and the non-elite
are not.
And then that could be, I don't want to go too far, but that could be a deep explanation of almost everything about politics, because the one question...
Wait, I think there's a theory about this.
The question that comes up with conspiracy theories is, why is it easy to spread conspiracy theories about government and big business? And part of it, I think, is because the kind of elite that can tell you how Wall Street really works is inherently suspicious to most people, because the kind of person who knows how Wall Street really works is a Wall Street insider. Mm-hmm. Whereas, when it's a security question, you can think, well, they're part of my tribe. The Wall Street tribe, no one's part of that tribe apart from the people in Wall Street. Or another version is, but as Tony Blair said of our election, when a traditional right-wing argument meets a traditional left-wing argument, you get the traditional result, which is the right-wing argument wins. Because this is obviously a cliche, but the right mobilizes through security rumors, the left mobilizes through economic rumors, but they're both elites. So if your finding is true, that's why the right always wins.
Except when they
don't.
They don't. It's actually also, David did a wonderful thing by setting up the answer to the debunking, which is that the member of the tribe who you would least expect to tell you the right answer can persuade and turn even the most avid skeptic into a believer. So when you get the woman who is a vaccine skeptic appearing on our national public radio in the US and saying, you know, I was a crunchy granola mom, I believed only in embracing natural things for my child, I wouldn't have, and my child wasn't vaccinated, I wouldn't feed her anything natural, so on and so on and so forth. I'm sorry, a crunchy mom, is that a like too inside baseball? Crunchy is short for sure.
That was also hard to understand.
Sorry, that's also inside baseball. Crunchy is short for granola mom, which means kind of a hippie, organic, California mom, all natural all the time.
No pesticides.
Right, no pesticides and no vaccines. So this woman went on National Public Radio and essentially said, I didn't have my child vaccinated. I was opposed to anything unnatural. When my child was 3 years old, she was diagnosed with autism anyway. I'm here to tell you that this link is fallacious, and I'm now seeing the consequences of not having children vaccinated, because now in California we have a large number of measles cases, so go get your child vaccinated. And those kind of people speaking, you know, maybe Michael Lewis leaves the Wall Street tribe and tells secrets. Right. So Michael Lewis has street cred with lots of people outside the Wall Street crowd, because he is, in the same way that de-radicalized folks who have engaged in terrorism, will be taken seriously by, people who are actively radical in ways that, despite, their vigorous and endless efforts, U.S. State Department efforts at public diplomacy will fail time and time again. So that's not the whole answer to your question, but we are out of time, and, David.
I'll add a very quick corollary, which is that and there's quite good experimental evidence showing that when the sort of predictable person shows up and makes the predictable argument, right, pushing on your belief systems, you dig in your heels.
Which goes to Aaron's question. Aaron's point about.
And that's been shown again and again and again for vaccines and other sorts of things.
Just in relation to the Wall Street thing, the reason it's so difficult is that for the Wall Street renegade not to be seen to be embittered, that's why it's hard.
It's all right.
Lewis
so more difficult.
Was get out, not because he got fired, but because he wanted to be a writer, and then
yes,
so,
right.
So
apolitical, pure-minded, objective, plausible, credible.
And new end to leave at the right time.
It's like it's the punchline means like only Nixon can go to China, right? It's the same sort of thing.
Okay. Well, at this point, let's check out that rumor about the alcohol. Thank you both very much, and thank you, Anika, for the response. And I'm sorry I forgot about you.
That's fine.